Let me start with a few examples of how this conflict might take the turn towards the worse. So these are real life examples. So in 2010, so these are cases that I was personally involved in or helping somebody. So the directorate of or the Drug Controls Administration, which issues certificates or registration for setting up pharmacies, so he's in possession of the certificate of, from the recognized pharmacist until the, that pharmacy is in operation. So one woman, so she wanted to terminate her license, so she didn't want to run it any longer and filed an application as per the process. The termination certificate was given to her, but her pharmacist certificate, which gives her the eligibility, was not returned, saying it is lost. It went on for a while, and later they realized that somebody else was using this certificate to run a pharmacy shop, which was a rampant practice back then, where the department officials would not return the certificates and then sell it in the black market. Now, they resorted to right information. So this was in 2010. And they stated the same thing. We lost it. And after filing a few applications, there's somebody, I think, who internally was aware of 81J, started saying we can't give it under 81J, even to the person whose certificate it was. And then, you know, after a spate of applications, then going to the commission, they finally had to give the certificate. But then somebody wanted to find how deep this rot was. So they wanted to, you know, find out how many such terminations happened, but how many certificates were not returned. Now, straight away, 81J was applied, saying this register cannot be supplied because it's private information of people who have submitted these certificates. Now, you can see what public interest is here, but the public information officer who was adjudicating this particular application refused to look beyond what is privacy of an individual. Then a very common thing, so there was this village called Korapalli in Karimnagar district. So a sarpanch, an ex-sarpanch and a panchayat secretary were misusing funds. So a few villagers got together, they came to know of this, they obtained some information using RTI, and then filed a complaint saying this, there was huge misuse to the tune of 9 to 10 lakh rupees in developmental funds. There's an inquiry ordered, the Zilla Parishad CEO conducted an inquiry, and he preliminary said, yes, there is diversion of funds, so it has to be recovered. Now the sarpanch went back to the government, so when we say government, it is to the secretariat, asking for a review of this inquiry. So the review happened, then the state government appointed another officer, so nothing was moving. So while the recovery was ordered by the CEO of the Zilla Parishad, the state government wanted to do another inquiry, but nothing moved forward. And the villagers went to the state government asking for the inquiry report, which saying the second inquiry I'm talking about, again, it was rejected under Section 81J. Now, here again, there is public interest, because it was public money that was being spent, and the rejection was laughable because they were saying, you know, they go back to the Girish Ramjan Deshpande case, saying, you know, it's a matter of inquiry between the state and an individual, allegation and an individual, so it can't, a third party cannot claim. Then we come to something that is very common, the Public Service Commission recruitments. There are a lot of people, even till today, feel wrongly cheated by the state. They don't have a lot of confidence in the Public Service Commission. They keep on asking for answer sheets, the merit list of any recruitment process. And time and again, the Public Service Commissions across the country, including the ones in this state and the United States as well as the bifurcated states, they've been denying information, citing 81J. Then there is another interesting case where so as per AICTE, so no individual is allowed to work in more than a single college. So you can't work in two colleges at the same time, so to speak. But there's rampant misuse of certificates. We have a great dearth of PhDs in the country. So these people actually sell PhDs. So one analysis we did with publicly available information on AICTE website, we found that there were about 50,000 duplicate names in about 5 states. Now, we had no way of checking whether the duplicate names mean, is it the same person or not, because names could match. The only way we could do it was, let's say, go a step beyond, you know, access date of birth, for instance, access something else which could establish that it's the same person whose name is available in 5 different colleges, 10 different colleges. Now, if you strictly go by privacy norms, you know, the state would say we can't give it, but this is affecting lives of lakhs of children, you know, because it directly affects quality of education. Now I think these are a lot of practical issues we have to look at when we look at the interplay between privacy and public interest. And unfortunately in India, we if you look at Section 81J that was referred to by Shailesh ji, public interest is not defined. It is very, very vague. Now, when it is very, very vague, I have seen very, very few judgments of commissions of Supreme Courts actually defining what public interest could be. And another practical problem is, so in the undivided state of Andhra Pradesh, we had more than 50,000 PIOs who quote unquote should take the application, then process it, use their mind as a quasi-judicial authority. And in the state of Telangana, now we have about 18,000. Now we're talking about these people who were at the grassroots, so a village, a panchayat secretary also becomes a PIO. Imagine him, you know, just imagine that he has to apply all this and add to the fact that most of them do not even have a copy of the act with them. The problem compounds. And you're asking somebody to apply this act, they don't have a copy of the act, and what they rely on is quote-unquote experts. Experts within the department who know how to reject, they call them up and say, okay, 81J is fine. So in this scenario, while the Supreme Court in all its wisdom can come up with laws defining what privacy is, etc., I think unless we look at the practical aspect of how it is going to be implemented on ground, these things are going to be very, very difficult. So more than 50% of rejections as on date, in at least I can speak for the state, happen under the pretext of 81J. So whenever an application is rejected, more than half of them under the pretext of 81J, and I'm sure most of them referring to the Girish Ramchandra Deshpande case. So the moment you ask any information related to any public servant who is working, they'll resort to Girish Ramchandra Deshpande saying, what is the public interest? There's no public interest. Now, so this brings back to a very, very important question. So even if you were to assume the Right to Information Act is not amended and stays as it is, so how do we define public interest? Now, quite often when we do workshops for public officials, they would come back and ask, what is public interest? Now, what is public interest has not been defined, except that I think the Tasmania Right to Information Act at least has a couple of schedules which talks about what are the relevant matters for public interest. So they list about 25 different things like, you know, things like do general public need this government information to be accessible, whether such a disclosure would inform a person about the reasons of government decision making, whether the disclosure would provide contextual information to aid the understanding of government decisions, whether the disclosure would enhance scrutiny of government administrative process, whether the disclosure would promote or harm the interests of an individual, etc. 25 different items. At the same time, they also very, very clearly say that there are four different matters that are irrelevant to the public interest test. So such as the motive of the person, the one who is asking for information, his motive is immaterial. Then it also talks about whether the disclosure would actually confuse the public, because public may not have the capacity to understand this information. So quite often, I think at least in the last 12 to 15 months, we've seen government often coming back with an explanation saying, no, this has to be understood in a certain way. It has been understood in a different way. So whenever there is an information that was in the press, which is damaging to the government, then information disclosure which would cause a loss of confidence in the government, that cannot be a reason to not consider public interest, and so on and so forth. So what I mean to say is, so in the lack of such underlying, I wouldn't say codification, but underlying guidelines, how would you expect a normal public influencer who is probably a graduate without any grounding in law, probably he is only aware of the laws that he is supposed to implement day in, day out in his functioning, we can't expect 81J to be, I mean, the Right to Information to be furthered. The UK Information Commission's office also defined, it didn't define what is public interest, but said these things should be considered. Things like, you know, is media coverage enough to say there is public interest? Now, a lot of times there are people at the grassroots who, you know, not aware of many laws, but know how to use Right Information. So quite often they attach paper clippings as a valid ground for public interest, saying there is an allegation on a public servant, so this allegation is enough ground for public interest. Now, unless we know, so the suspicion starts there, that is, the allegation does not amount to conviction, but there is sufficient evidence. Now, most often PIOs don't consider this as a valid ground for public interest, saying, you know, press is sold out, they're polarized, how do you believe such reports? So in, we have a situation where even part of the evidence, which is the only evidence available to citizens, because they can't have sources within the government like journalists who can pursue information. So even that small bit of evidence that they have is rejected, saying this is not a ground for public interest. Now, how else can people, common citizens, prove there is public interest to override the privacy clause, saying, you know, though public servants also are citizens, also enjoy right to privacy, there's a larger public interest in divulging this information. Then secondly, so to add to what Shailesh was saying, a lot of cases where, for instance, even any information about vigilance cases, corruption cases, are these days rejected under the pretext of 81J and Girish Ramchand Deshpande. To the extent that in most cases, a lot of PIOs are not even aware that remuneration particulars or salary particulars are already enshrined as part of Section 4. So they still ask us, does salary come under private information? Now, in such a scenario, you know, what can privacy do? Then education qualification certificate. So since it is understood that a lot of people actually forge certificates to get into government, so it becomes a very, very valid ground, because somebody, it directly affects decision making, it directly affects a lot of things. And then there have been cases where, because medical records are sacrosanct, there have been cases where people have misused medical records to get maternity leave. 6 months and did something else, you know, all the while drawing public salary to the tune of lakhs of rupees. Now, if such medical, if there is a suspicion, should medical records be disclosed? Now, all these are, I don't have answers to them, but what I meant to say is, beyond what is given in judgments, I think there's a lot of practical issues on the ground. We can't leave it to those, you know, if we could look at 16,000 in the state, I'm sure there are 4 lakh, 5 lakh PIOs across the country. You can't leave it to them to decide what is public interest, what is privacy, what is not, and what is harm. And if we allow the amendment as per the Data Protection Bill, so every small thing is a harm. You can say reputation is a harm. And in fact, if I go by those 10 terms, even salary should not be disclosed now. The salary particular should not be disclosed. You know, what time do they come in, what time do they go out. A lot of attendance registers are sought under right information. Especially in the education department in schools. Now even that will not be given, because you know it would qualify as one of those principles of harm. So I think what the movement largely has been demanding is, one, no amendment to the Right to Information Act. At the same time, any information about allocation and use of public resources, wherever public money is involved, should not be exempt. I mean, there is enough public interest. And secondly, anyway, because social audit is becoming a norm for most government schemes, large government schemes with an outlay of hundreds of crores, social audit would not exist without access to information. So today, if you look at the National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, the auditors are equipped, given information to the extent of the name of the beneficiary, the kind of work they have done, their age, to ascertain whether this is the same person, you know, whose name is written in the master roll. Now, without access to such information, social audit would not have any meaning. Now there is sufficient public interest. I think privacy is a concept is yes, it has to be a fundamental right, but does it apply to government servants, especially in the context of discharging their duties, not in their personal lives? Does it apply to people discharging their duties, public functions? Has to be, I think, discussed at length. And unless I'm not saying codify what is public interest, which is not possible anyway, is to at least come up with some kind of guidelines to say, good, these constitute public interest, these may not constitute public interest. Unless that happens, I think this whole, we're just going around a vicious cycle. Thank you.